But what he was really trying to say is that he was not a follower of the more rigorous regime there, the revolutionary, so-called revolutionary government, that he was for freedom, etc. And he went on and on and on and on, and then he tells me, well, I want to come to America. I want to live in Las Vegas. And I said, Las Vegas? And he said, yes. And he'd seen some movie. I don't know what it was because I don't watch movies, but about Las Vegas. And he thought it was the greatest place to live. And I said, look, I lived 15 years in Las Vegas. I hate to tell you, but this is not your ideal nirvana, living in Las Vegas. So anyway, the others. Now, the guy on the end was the opposite. He was a Heideggerian studying existentialist philosophy, but he couldn't study it. They could only study sociology. They all said they were students of sociology. I think she was a nursing student, but otherwise. And I was a sociologist, so they know, oh, now I was a professor. And then we had a lot of good conversations. But that was his cover-up to studying this Heideggerian philosophy, existentialist philosophy. But they were so friendly, and as I say again, a number of them. She was the leader of the group, by the way, and they had just been spending the day, as they did every week. They went and visited places where they had hospitals, where they had the elderly and people who were like had mental handicaps. And since I have both, I'm both, they gave me the flowers. But, you know, and it started raining, so we wanted to get out of the rain and kind of away from where we might be seen. So we went, ducked into a, I said, well, let's go get some tea. So we went into a tea shop. They insisted on paying the bill. They wouldn't let us, even, you know, and they had nothing going to school. You know, we wanted to treat him some tea. No, they had to do it for us. And then this is another young man that we met over there. He is from Afghanistan. And he was there because he does not want to be involved in war with the United States. So he's there selling pomegranates and trying to find ways of peace. Now, I was showing these films in one of the other cities, and two young men that were grandchildren of one of the ladies setting up came along to carry all our books and stuff. And so it was a lecture hall, and he was sitting up at the top, and he was sitting there, and I mentioned about this young Afghani, and he doesn't want to fight any war with America. And he's going, yes, yes, from the back row, you know, yes, he doesn't want to fight any war. And his mother, his grandmother told me afterwards, well, I'm so afraid he's graduating from high school. I'm so afraid he's going to end up in Afghanistan. He's saying, no, 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 no. And that's our worst nightmare that we had. The worst, I still have that feeling that, you know, as I see young college students, high school students about that age of, you know, getting caught up in the military, and I see these young people, and I think, oh my God, that's my worst nightmare, that we would end up with war with each other. And knowing from my long pursuit of the issue of nuclear weapons way back from when I was in the military, the thought that we could easily tip over into nuclear war, it's just a nightmare, just a nightmare. And how anybody could call anything like that, even bringing us close to that, a just war is inconceivable. There's no just war in the world of nuclear weapons because all our generals and experts say any war today can easily become nuclear war, as we can see with the danger in the Middle East right now. Pakistan, they're very upset with us for dropping bombs, and especially from drones, on their houses, and Pakistan has nuclear weapons. It will not be a couple of planes probably flying into some towers unless they're armed with nuclear weapons. So, you know, we have to be pursuers of peace. Hafiz, so we went here with that young group. We were here at this, also went to this tomb of Hafiz, which is their great poet. And that's, you know, we were commenting in one place I was at that most of our parks have statues of, they're almost always military heroes, like right here from the Revolutionary War or whatever. But they have poets. But this is actually the tomb of the most famous poet, Hafiz, and there's also another, Saeed. The world to me has been a home. Wherever knowledge could be sought through different climes, I'd love to roam. In other words, that very great desire to know the knowledge of all people was very much, and he's the poet of love. He writes these very love poems, which are pretty hot, by the way, for a 14th century writer. Anyway, so we went there with these young people, and that's where the young people kind of go to places like that, because like I said, they don't have discos and all that. This couple came up, though, that they knew, so they introduced me to this couple, and then they had by then found out that I was a priest. So he said, well, Father, marry them so then they can kiss. Because they can't, a young couple couldn't kiss in public if they weren't married. So he wanted me to marry them so then they could kiss. Oh, so the terrible thing was that war between 80 and 88 and the effects of it. And so the directors of the Foreign Affairs Ministry set us up a meeting with them, and you can see the one in the wheelchair has nothing below the hip, and from the effects of the chemicals, etc. And he had tears coming down his eyes when we walked up, because one of his closest friends from the war had just died that day, even some years later. So they're setting up a memorial in Iran. This is on that pillar right there. And this is the doctor, head doctor in the country, who's setting up this, the effects of the war, setting up a museum for peace. And there's the results of the mustard gas and all that came from Fort Dix, from the United States, most probably, and what it did. That's what weapons of mass destruction, chemical, biological, nuclear, can do. Here was where, very interesting, we had this wonderful meeting with the people, and we shared our stories, and David shared the fact that he's Quaker, and that his mother used to go to Fort Dix, where those weapons come from, in New Jersey, and vigil there. And so he was telling about how she went just every day that she wasn't working, and they had moved from New Jersey to Oregon. And so she was in a store one day, and this man came up to her and said, were you ever down there in New Jersey at Fort Dix? And this, and she said, well, yes, I used to vigil there. And he said, well, I want you to know, you're the reason I quit making bombs there. You know, so we do vigiling, and we do these things and all that, and we think, what good does this do? What good does this do? Well, I know from my vigiling at the test site, I became very good friends with the person who ran the whole Nevada test site out there. We became very close friends. He became a big advocate for what we were doing. And when Tom Gumbleton came, Bishop Gumbleton, and crossed the line, he did too. So he became an advocate for peace. He died of cancer, and most of us feel that that was from his long career. He was the one who was up in a cloud taking pictures with a lens he had developed of the first H-bomb that went off. And when it went off, he was sure it was the end of the world, that really though it would never stop. There's always that fear that the chain reaction wouldn't start. And he was convinced that that was happening. But he became, like these people, advocates of peace. She cried when we told our stories, and she said, I've heard Americans say something about the war, but I've never been touched as I have hearing your stories. So in August, I'm going to Hiroshima and Nagasaki. That's my next big trip. I'll be back with a news show next year. No, just kidding. But anyway, you know, just to say we have to work together. You felt the heat. We have to account for it. The young man on the end there, the man on the end, is a filmmaker, and he was a pilot of a captain of a ship, but an Iranian ship similar to the one that shot down the airplane. And as a captain of a ship, he could not understand how that captain could have shot down an airliner. And so he kept trying to find out, and he did research even in the United States, and Newsweek magazine had a study of that, about that mentality of having to achieve and show that you could get a kill, that you could bring down a plane, etc. Now, eager that captain was to do that. The difference between that captain and the pilot I flew with and myself was that he was eager to show that they could shoot down a plane. I had avoided being in bombers because I was so afraid of getting a kill, a win, and so we were so cautious that we saved the people on that plane. So it is something about learning not how to engage with people in violence of war, but in nonviolent ways. We met not just with people in parks. These were members of parliament. It would be like going to Washington and meeting with congresspeople, which is very difficult to do. Any of you have done, that's why we're just watching Medea Benjamin accosting Secretary Rumsfeld at the awards the other night for the president, that how they do go and just try to meet people wherever they can, because it's very hard to get an appointment to sit down with a congressperson. But they met, we went to their parliament. These are actual members of parliament who represent the various minority religions instead of a state or something. That's who they represent in their parliament. But they're actual members of parliament. They also have women representatives, special representatives, because they don't have that many elected by the government. But anyway, they spent about an hour and a half, 2 hours with us. And again, just constantly concerned about peace. One represents the Jews, Zoroastrians, which is their oldest religion, Armenian and Assyrian Christians, which are the major Christian denominations. And the one that was Jewish, representing the Jewish talk, I showed you the young Max, the young 24-year-old, he just really leaned on him. He says, Max, you have to talk to the Jewish constituency in the United States about, you know, what is going on, like in Gaza. I was going on at the time that we'd see only way to peace or we are going to end up in, you know, nuclear war, I guess. Disgust. They have this all over their building, these kinds of signs. And as I said, the sign somebody made for me. Communication, not domination. So finally we say farewell to our friends, the serious workers and the families that we met and came to love. This was David's t-shirt, Peace with Iran. And so there's Iran right there. But one little sticky wicket that still lies is Iran trying to develop nuclear weapons. And the International Agency on Atomic Energy, as I said, says no, they are not. They are eager to develop a nuclear reactor because they have a lot of oil, but they don't have refineries. They need more energy. They have every right to do it because they are signers of the Nuclear Nonproliferation Treaty, which gives them the right, as long as they abide by that, to develop nuclear reactors, and they do it under the eyes of the international agency, and that seems to be agreed upon by the agency. Nevertheless, they're surrounded by countries that have nuclear weapons. It would not be terribly surprised, especially since we had taught them how to do it years ago, if they moved in that direction, and that's why we have to do everything we can to build bridges of peace. What are we doing, though, in response? On our side, this is not directed yet at Iran, but this is our newest wave, and that is drones. So we came back here, and then we went to Nevada, and Judy and George came. We have a peace march every year out to the Nevada test site from Las Vegas, and we went on the way out is Creech Air Force Base. This plane is located in Afghanistan or Pakistan. It bombs Afghanistan and Pakistan, but it is really operated by a pilot and a not exactly a co-pilot, but the job like I had in the back seat of a fighter plane that directs the intercepts, etc. And he is the cameraman, because the most important thing they have on the front there is these very expensive cameras that they can take these very intense pictures from very high up. And then they send it through satellite back to Nevada, to that trailer, and they can figure out where the target should be. And then they operate, and this young person who's usually like 19 years old, the pilot has been trained and been in combat, but the sensor operator is just out of training, out of boot camp, but their experience has been arcades, you know, playing games of shooting down planes, and now this is for real. Do they really consciously know the difference? We call them hunter-killer platforms. So our way of relating to the people of Iran and Pakistan is to send hunter-killer platforms called Grim Reapers. And so we were very disturbed at this, and we are finding out the commander himself talked, and he was on 60 Minutes, by the way, last Sunday, if you saw that. He didn't tell the whole story. He didn't tell the story. He told reporters, it was in the paper, about the problem of these young people that are directing the intercepts, directing the missiles, that are having problems, and that he's had to get more psychologists and chaplains to help them with what we call post-traumatic stress disorder. Because there was one case where they blew up a school. 30 children were killed. In F-16s, you drop your bomb and you keep going. You never see what you've done. But in traditional bombing, these drones stay there for hours and hours. They can stay 10, 20 hours, depending on, this is the bigger one. The smaller ones can stay about 24. These stay about 10. And the crew are on for 12 hours. So they are watching after they drop the bomb. They see, excuse me, but the body parts, etc., the plane place blown up. the people running, scurrying, people fleeing the neighborhood. I mean, they see all of that. And then they're going to go, the commander.